So we're going to get started. Thank you everyone for coming. This is out in the open, next level OER at OU. And I'm going to run through some, a little bit of background very, very quickly because I want to spend most of the time with panelists talking. Open educational resources are teaching, learning, and research resources released under a license that permits their use by others. This is kind of a long way of saying that these are resources that can be modified. They don't go fall under traditional, they are copyrighted, but they have additional permissions that allow instructors to do additional things with them. We talk about these often as textbooks, but they can be lots of different things, as you'll find out. So the big thing about them is that they can be modified. And these are kind of the five permissions of open educational resources. And these are the ability to retain, to reuse, to revise, remix, and redistribute. I told you I was going to go fast on this. All of the panelists up here have been grantees of the library's alternative textbook grants. And this is a yearly competitive grant. It's open to full-time OU faculty members. The grants range between $250 and $2,500. There has been support from both the College of Arts and Sciences and the Price College of Business. And we will continue to advocate for more support. And what these grants are designed to do is to help faculty transition from a traditional textbook and traditional course materials to openly licensed resources. And this can be done in a number of ways. To date, and this has been going on for 3 years at OU, to date we've saved students $772,000 in textbooks and course fees. So this is absolutely phenomenal. I'm going to talk a little bit more about the alternative textbook grant at the end of this presentation, right before I ask for questions. But I really want, like I said, I really want to get the panel started talking because they are the ones with the expertise doing this, and that's why you're here, is to hear from them. So I'm going to ask first, and I should say, Dr. Heather Ketchum was supposed to be here, and she very regretfully could not make it. She lives quite a ways out and also in quite a rural location. So she did not feel comfortable driving in because she was getting freezing rain. But the rest of the panelists are projected up here, but I would like each of them to introduce themselves, give your name, give your department, and just a very brief discussion of what OER, what you did, and what OER you adopted. Let's start with Dr. Davis.
I'm Chad Davis. I'm officially in the School of Electrical and Computer Engineering, but I teach a lot of courses in the ENGR, which is just the engineering, kind of the general engineering courses. And one of the courses that I have been teaching for the last 5 years or so has been a Circuits for Non-Majors class, and that's the class that I adopted, that I created the book, two different books for, and that's the one I'll talk about.
My name is Cody Taylor. I'm an emerging technologies librarian. I don't teach classes. However, I have been working for this grant program and the folks in the library working on these issues since their beginning in the library. And I've, not so much in these panelists, but that's just by chance. I work with those who we award grants to help them create their resources, adapt resources that they find out in the open to their classes.
I'm Julie Ward. I'm an assistant professor of Spanish in the Department of Modern Languages, Literatures, and Linguistics. The course that I use an OER for is Introduction to Hispanic Literatures and Cultures. And I basically, instead of using the normal anthology textbook we generally have, I got a collection of texts in the public domain and created activities around them through Canvas. And then the second phase is that the students themselves made critical editions of texts that will then go into an open anthology for future use. So that's it.
I'm Robert Shevich, a professor in chemistry and biochemistry. The course that this grant applied to is Chemistry 3053, which is organic chemistry, biological emphasis, but in reality what it really is organic chemistry for non-majors, primarily pre-med students. It's a course of about 240, 250 people, depending on which room we get to teach it in at a given semester. And the funding was used to help support the development of problem sets for students to complement a transition over to online textbooks.
Okay, thank you. So I want to ask, I'm going to say anyone, we don't need to go in order, because not everyone is going to have something to say about everything. But I want to ask you, what compelled you to use OER in your classrooms? Go ahead.
I'll jump in.
Yes.
Student comments. So the first year adopting the use of an online textbook, students almost unanimously were critical of the lack of problems that are traditionally found in paper copy textbooks. And you can also usually get a student problem manual that accompanies the textbook when you purchase it. That was totally missing from the online resources, and that was clearly apparent in student criticisms about the first version of this. So that's what to push towards the development of this resource.
I would say that when I first started teaching, the textbook comments and evaluations are always really bad. Talk about how many books were and things like that. So I've always tried to create my own material and supplement the book. And that was usually what the students used more of, was the materials that I created. And a lot of students would tell me, oh, I shared my book with, you know, my notes with other people and things like that. So Cody was one of my students who liked my notes and shared them with people. And he just said, hey, why don't you write a book? That's kind of what led me to do it. But in the end, I was always wanting to do something like this because I think you can really customize the content for your course a lot better. These books are so much stuff they don't need, and they don't know where to find the right information.
The next question I have is multifaceted. There's a lot of parts to it. So we all can guess that your students appreciated not having to pay for a textbook or paying a much lower cost, but I think in all cases they did not pay. But what other responses did you get from them? Did your students contribute to the OER in any way? And were there changes to your pedagogy that came about because of your use of open materials?
I can start on this one. So because my students were contributing to a future version of this textbook that they were just getting the texts for this class, I noticed a huge increase in engagement at the end of the project. It was a group project, and each group chose one text. We had a mini kind of a fair, and they showed their critical editions. And we invited the librarians, and we invited people from the Office of Undergraduate Research. And hearing them talk about their texts, I was really impressed with the level of just how they were really experts on their own text. And I had students tell me that they didn't know that you could do research in literature, for example, that they learned that was even a thing from doing this project. So that was very encouraging for me, hoping that they'll continue to take upper division courses in literature. And also, the other thing that I think is really important, they're very excited about the fact that their work will be published online, available for other people to use. I think it makes it much more significant and meaningful.
I'll say there were two groups of students that I saw impacted by the grant. And the one group was the graduate students, two of whom I had recruited onto the project. It was a rather expansive project, so it wasn't something that one person could develop in a reasonable amount of time. And so finding two graduate students who had an interest in pursuing careers in academia, teaching specifically, giving them a chance to try to develop curriculum materials and again to get their name on something that is out there as a citable document that they could also put on their CVs. They all found that very positive. The students who were the recipients of the materials and supposed to be using it, I found this actually pretty interesting this year to see how students were using the document. And the whole purpose of creating this problem set was to complement these online textbooks so that students wouldn't have to purchase them. And I'll just give you an idea. The current textbook that other sections at OU are using, and then of course at other universities, it's a book by Klein. It's roughly $260 to buy it new, and about $100, $150 to buy it used. Thought students would really like that. I was surprised actually by the number of students who still opted to buy a book despite not being encouraged or told to do so. And that was something I did not expect, but I certainly saw a lot of. So I don't know how and why they're using it and whether or not they feel it's filling gaps or they just have a greater level of comfort with a textbook, something they can hold and use. But I think that's something that needs to be looked into and addressed in the future and figure out why they're still doing that. At the same time, I think Chad's comments about students really liking the material that you prepare. I have found also this semester that there's a much greater reliance on the materials I prepared and gave out to students as opposed to going and digging into these online books and so forth. So I saw that big increase as well.
I'd say my students, the cost was huge for them. I think when I started teaching, they had a textbook that was a full-blown service textbook, $200-something. And that actually only covered about 20% of the topics in this three one-hour course sequence that went through the whole semester. It's a really odd thing that engineering department's doing right now. We have several different one-hour classes that last 6 weeks. So imagine taking a thermo class and having to buy a thermo book, taking a stats class, and all these different classes they have to buy full books for. So it's like three times the cost. So when I took over the class, I saw that they have to buy this big book and it only covers a portion of the topics. I found a really high level FE review book that covered all the topics, but not very well. But at least it was cheap and it covered everything. And then I supplemented with all my stuff. So going from that to the cheap high level book was a big savings, and then getting rid of that and doing those are really big savings. And also I would say that they helped me a lot because my deadline was right before the class started. So I had like bonus points for people who found mistakes and things like that. So they get into that, telling you the teacher's wrong. They're all over that. So that's a good way to get it edited in a short time frame.
So the next question that I have, and again, kind of a two-part, I suppose. What challenges did you have kind of revising your course, revising the class, integrating this new content, new approach into your syllabus? And then kind of more generally, what are other challenges that you faced? So kind of a more specific component and a more general component.
I'd say that there were a couple things that surprised me in terms of challenges. And one of the challenges, just even over the course of the semester, was what I call the shifting sands of URLs and websites. Something that was active in the summer when I was preparing the syllabus, and then by October when students are supposed to be looking at it, it doesn't exist or it's not there. And so you're trying to find it again. That's a little more work than anticipated, trying to find these things. The other side was the students themselves. I was surprised, again, at the level of lack of technical savvy that I assume most students had in terms of, well, how do I take that website that's in your syllabus and look it up? And seeing them trying to type up strings of things and missing them and messing up, I was like, well, it's just clickable. And then there were also things that came back to me of compatibility issues. I worked on a PC, and the students were complaining in droves of, well, these links aren't working. What's wrong with them? And if I had a student come to my office and show me, it was an Apple issue. And for some reason, these particular links wouldn't work on Apple. So, it was all these little things that weren't expected about technology that really gum things up in the beginning. But
I can relate to the Mac Apple issue. I almost spent some of my money to buy a Mac just so I could test out these things, because there's so many issues I have with those. Because I'm also a PC person, but yeah, that's always a big problem. The big challenge I had when me and Cody first started talking about doing a circuits book, and we were thinking, oh, there'll be something out there, we'll just take it and then just tweak it a little bit, modify it, and it'll be, you know, not that hard. But I just found that as far as that domain, there's not a lot of material out there. So I ended up going from thinking I was going to do a slight modification to an existing document to kind of, you know, customize it for my class, to writing everything from scratch. And I was not expecting that. So that was very difficult.
If I may, could each of you perhaps discuss how you're delivering content to your students, how you went about either writing it or editing it, and then how you delivered it?
I can start with that. I started out talking to Cody about using LaTeX and some of the fancy, what was the one you said, the publisher, the Windows publisher or something like that, different types of things that I'm not comfortable with. And I decided just the time frame was too short. I had to just write it in Word, because that's all I really was comfortable with. And that was a big challenge. The figures with Moo and grouping things, and I spent most of my time trying to make the figures work in Word. But so I created Word, turned it to a PDF, and then posted it on my course website. That's how I did mine.
Did your students work? They seemed fine with the PDF.
I had no complaints over just doing a PDF. But we wanted to make it an online book, but we just didn't have time to make it an online interactive book. But I think it's been okay with the PDF. The problem I'm worried about is, having to constantly edit it. That document gets out there, and it's, got mistakes in it. I can't really pull those back very easily. The online book, you can always update those.
So Jen and I, and the efforts of our office, are working on a workflow to allow authors such as these to write their content once and publish it in many different formats. So that could be a PDF, or maybe it's HTML that gets published on the web, maybe in ebook format. Students prefer. It's something that we'll be working with Dr. Davis on in the future, Dr. Ward, and perhaps you as well, if you'd like. So these are issues that we're addressing, authoring and publication.
So there's also an aspect to bringing students up to speed. When a student's trying to show you something on a computer, you realize that you're using Windows what? Well, that's why you can't see anything. There's a lot of students just being way behind from where I thought they should be in terms of technology, or trying to access insane amounts of information on cell phones. That's why it's not working. Or not realizing their cell phone is drawing from, not Wi-Fi, but whatever the other, your signal. Yeah, I'm coming from your carrier, so, what's your problem? So there was a lot of that stuff that I think just students need to be introduced to think about early on in the process.
Cody, would you mind talking a little bit, because we're talking about challenges, some of the additional challenges in the formats of these documents? And you talked a little bit about in the future we are hoping to have a kind of a publishing workflow, but kind of more generally about kind of the state of where these things live and how people access them and how and if people can modify them.
Right. So I'm going to use Dr. Davis as an example. So he's publishing his books as PDFs to students, and I don't know if any of you have ever tried to edit a PDF. It is nearly impossible to do. So what I proposed to Jen and what we're moving forward with is having grantees author their contents, or author their books as plain text documents. These are easy to share. They are able to be converted into a number of different formats, those that I mentioned earlier, including HTML and PDFs, and even Word docs if you choose to publish those. These plain text documents can be edited in any
text editor, so there's no problem of Mac or PC here. It's every machine that any of you own can edit a plain text document, I promise. And with some tools that exist and some perhaps interfaces to these tools that Jen and I are working on, converting these plain text documents to a number of other formats is becoming increasingly easy. So it requires minimal technical expertise on the part of the author to publish these resources in a number of different ways.
And I just want to follow up on that too, to say that one of the reasons that we feel that this is important is that these documents, this content is meant to be shared and reused and repurposed. And this is one of the whole points. If you can find, you know, one of these that they've written, but then you can take pieces of it and mix it and mash it with another piece that you found, and the terms of the licensing allow for that. And so you can really create something custom, except it's very, very challenging if you can't get to these things.
Right.
So that is a problem that we hope to solve. And this kind of flows might have already covered this, but what if anything would you do differently next time? If you were given another grant tomorrow, what would you do differently?
I can answer that. So one of my challenges was finding texts that are in the public domain or otherwise publishable, shareable. And my field is contemporary Latin American literature, so the things I'm most comfortable with are generally really recent. So I worked with Jen and Cody and also Karen to find a list of works that would be useful and reasonable in this course. And then the other part of that was having students, as they created their critical edition that will then be included in the OER, having them license it for sharing. And so I gave them the choice of what kind of license they wanted to give, and I realized later that maybe I should have said, if you want this to be part of the anthology, this is the license. This particular license is the one you should use. So it's still up to them whether they want to do it or not, but maybe restrict the range so that everything is under the same license. So that's one thing that came up that I would do differently.
I'm gonna interject a little bit too, just because I'm familiar with this. I do think, on the other hand, it is really important that the authors of these are allowed to choose whatever, and what you're proposing, they still would.
Mm-hmm.
They may not be a part of the final product,
right.
But I think it is really important that you're able to choose whatever license that you want to choose.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
One thing I would say is I got a lot of feedback and evaluations stating that they like this and different things about the books. And one thing that the two main, I guess, cohorts in the classes I taught these books were the mechanical engineers and chemical engineers, and they have a hard time caring about circuits, believe it or not. That's electrical stuff. I was the same way. I got a mechanical engineering degree, and I hated circuits. So I understand that philosophy, and so what I started doing is putting more and more examples that they care about in the book, and I think that really helped. And the first book I didn't do it as much on, and then the second book I really did a lot, and I think that that was from feedback, and just realizing, oh yeah, I have the ability to do that now, to try to find things that are interesting to those different types of engineers. So being able to customize it to your audience is helpful. It's something that I wish I'd have done more of.
Surprising I had kind of come to the same realization. Fortunately, before I was writing the problem set, I realized students really, well, many of the non-majors are missing why are they taking chemistry. So trying to find problems that would really focus on them and their needs and the classes they would be taking. But it's surprising now getting the pushback from the other direction, saying, why are these problems so different than all the others out there? They're like big molecules, and drugs, and all these things, and they don't look like all the small molecules and other people's problems. And I'm like, oh my God. I think it's more about finding a level of comfort for you dealing with the students and introducing them to you than it is ever satisfying such a large and diverse group.
So I think certainly Cody and I think of OER as very living documents that they can go through. I mean, that's one of the benefits that since they're not traditionally published, when things change, the content can be changed and updated very quickly. So I want to say, since these are living documents, are you planning to make change? Well, first of all, are you planning to continue to use them in the next semester and beyond? And what kind of changes do you anticipate making to them?
Well, my class is a 3 1-hour course sequence, and I did the first one and the third one. So I haven't done the second class, and it's the one's the hardest because it's got all kinds of crazy topics in it, sensors, digital logic, just you name it, it's in there. So what I'm going to try to do is figure out a way to like maybe get that other class in, and then I can continually add new examples. And in the technology area, you really want to have a document that can change with the times. So there's a new technology that comes out, you can address that with examples. So that's what I see over the years, being able to keep injecting new things in there that the students care about.
So I plan to use the student-generated anthology and future sections of the class, and then the idea is that they will then create new critical editions that will be added so that the anthology will just keep growing with every semester or year.
I like the idea of offering points for finding stuff. I should have done that. So the answer to your question is yes, an update is coming. The way design this kind of project overall is that it wasn't a single year. It's going to be multiple years in development just because of the scope of what was desired and needed. So there's going to be a version or a second edition of volume one. And then there will be a volume two. So in that way, new content can be introduced as required as times change and new ideas come up and new things want to be incorporated into the course. So I see it as a multi-volume series with additions being created as needed.
I would add one more thing. One thing that I was able to, I got the book done, but the appendix was kind of weak. I wanted to add some supplementary materials. And one thing that I wasn't quite ready to do was my project for my class. So I have projects in my classes that I don't put in my book at all. It's just like a separate document that the students work on. But these projects that I create are pretty, I mean, they're, you know, I've written papers about them, things like that. I want to try to get those in the book also so that can get shared out there. People can, you know, look at the appendix for all the different projects you can do for the course. So one's a hands-on certs project that I think would be really handy for a lot of non-major certs courses. So I want to try to get that in there sometime soon.
So this is the question that I'd like us to spend, you to spend, the most time on. So I said not everyone has to answer everything, but I would like to everyone to answer this. And this is, what advice would you give to other instructors who are considering OER for their classes?
I would say that it takes a lot of time. But it's, I think it's worth it. I'm still not 100% sure it's worth it, but I think it is. It's so nice to be able to say, okay, what am I going to cover today? Oh, just go write the next section of my book. That's what I need to cover. And the students know that too. And you know, having the class and the book go together is so important. That's never happened before for me. I never agree with the way the book is taught. You know, it's always jumping around. Okay, go to chapter 8 now, then back to 2. So you don't have to do that anymore, and the students and you are all in sync better, so that's a huge benefit. And but it does take a lot of time, especially your first one. The second one, I was able to do a lot faster because I knew what I was doing a little bit. First time, it's going to be a challenge just to get all of the, you know, the computer issues, things like that, software issues.
So some advice that I would give to people writing books would be to iterate on them. I think we've heard from everyone here that whether they found errors in what they've already written or what they've borrowed from others, but they can also
change the resource to better fit their class, right? So you found that some people don't like circuits examples, we can change the materials to better suit them. And I think that's it. But iterating over time is something wise to do.
I think my advice would be to see this project as a collaboration. I couldn't have done this all by myself. I got an enormous amount of support from the libraries and also from the students. And so I think seeing, knowing how to ask for help is really important, planning ahead, and using all the resources you have available to you. Because I think, and then remember too that your students, like you all have said, having them help you with editing and things like that. So remembering that you're not just doing it all by yourself is probably the best advice I can think of.
I would say that given experiences had thus far that what I noticed as problems, how they crept up, what they were, and how I dealt with them, that in hindsight, I would have taken more time to explain in the syllabus and during the first week or second week of class how and what I'm doing. I took it as a given that your stuff is there, use it. And that I think was actually foreign to many students. They had not experienced it at OU. They had already been through several courses with traditional textbooks and hadn't ever experienced anything like this before. And so they were caught off guard. Maybe that'll change down the road. Maybe people will become more used to it. Maybe by the time they're in their senior level courses, they'll just be old pros at it. But truth of the matter is, many students just weren't ready to make that switch over as much as I thought they would. And so I will be spending more time in the future trying to explain and communicate to the students, this is what I'm doing, this is how it'll best serve you if you do it this way.
I think one thing that you could try to do is add a little salesmanship in your book itself. And you know, I'm always trying to, you know, brainwash people into thinking they really should be motivated for this class. And I know they're not, but try to convince them that it's important for them. And that's something you can do in the book. You can, you know, even in the preface, you can write a description that makes them excited about the book. And you don't have that ability to just purchase a book and give it to them. You know? So I think I was able to motivate the students a little bit more with that. And one other thing I should have mentioned in the past is the students helped a lot with editing, but my TAs did nothing. The teaching assistants, I said, hey, you know, you guys are paid, so you need to read the book and give me edit, you know, it's like that. And I just kind of left it as, if you see anything, let me know. And if I do it again, I'm going to be like, you're going to spend 1 hour reading, you know. So force your TAs to get involved because they won't just do it because they want to. Students want to correct you, but TAs don't. They're busy, you know, doing other things. So get them involved. Like you said, you had TAs help you, right?
Well, actually, just my students.
Okay.
Oh, you mean?
Yeah, you had TAs, you had students. So
yeah.
You were like student driven, but the TAs helped you more than I didn't get that. So.
Well, I actually used the funds specifically to help supplement the summer salary with them. So,
okay.
They,
so yeah,
they were given specific instructions by me. This is X percent of your salary per week, therefore, I expect X percent of your week spent on this. Granted, you are a volunteer for this. It's not like someone was, hey, do it for a while. I know, they volunteered for it, but you know, it was tied into really their career goals and mission. So I think the system worked out very well.
It just needs to be formally, you know, explained how it's going to work, I think, to get the help you need to do something like this.
Cody, I'm going to put you on the spot for a second, and then
sure.
I'm sorry, but I think you'll be fine. I mentioned that one of our, I'm realizing this is a slightly different panel than what I envisioned, and because one of our panelists was not able to make it today. And while Dr. Ketchum, so all of these people have really kind of created their own OER, which is absolutely not the way that I would say the majority of instructors do things. A lot of them just adopt something solely or wholly. And Dr. Ketchum, although she made major revisions, took an OpenStax, an existing open textbook, and made revisions. And I'm wondering if you could talk, because you were here for that, if you could talk about her process, because it is different. And I think, you know, you hear people saying this takes a lot of time, and it does. No matter what way, it does take time, and I think that's what the grants are help to assist with. But it doesn't have to take as much time as creating something from scratch. So could you talk about the process a bit? Thank you.
Absolutely. So Dr. Ketchum used her funds to create a book for her anatomy and physiology. I'm sorry. For her physiology class, she used an OpenStax textbook that covered both anatomy and physiology. So she, with the help of a postdoc student, I believe, removed the anatomy portion of that anatomy and physiology book, while at the same time tailoring the physiology content to her specific class.
Thank you.
Sure.
So those are all the questions that I have for the panelists. I want to talk a little bit about next year's alternative textbook grant. And then I want to ask you all for questions. So we are announcing today that we will be, again, having the alternative textbook grant for 2017. We have come up with kind of an expanded support model. In some cases, we've just kind of formalized some of the things that we are already doing. And in other cases, we are going to be having new services. So one of the ways this is going to manifest itself is that we will be putting grantees into categories. So you can replace your textbook with library resources. And even though these are not OER per se, because they are not licensed openly, it is still displacing an expensive textbook. So that would be one category, and we have a level of support for people who choose that route. There's a different level of support for the people who will be adopting a textbook. Yet another level of support for people who are modifying. And so taking pretty much what's out there and making kind of minimal changes to it. And then, again, another level of support for people who are creating. And we are also kind of formalizing some of the things that grantees will agree to. We'll be holding an orientation workshop, and all of the grantees will need to attend that. Otherwise, I think that the terms of the grant are pretty open, and you can tell many people have used their funds for very different things. Our application is going to open, I have Tuesday up here, but it will probably be open on Monday, and applications are due on March 31st. And for me, this is a really, really exciting year, because as I said, throughout the past 3 years, this initiative has saved students $772,000 in fees or textbook costs, and this is the year that we will break $1 million, and that's just remarkable. So to find out more information about the alternative textbook grant, and actually about lots of open initiatives going on, open.ou.edu is the place to go, and there are links to the alternative textbook grant and forms and submissions and all of that, and the link to the submission will go live on Monday. So with that, I would like to open this up for the next 10 minutes to audience questions. Does anyone have questions for panelists? Yes.
I'd like to ask the panelists to describe relationship between whatever LMS you're using and your text. Did you start out with material prepared on the LMS and use that as kind of a first starting point? Do you use both material, prepared material, both for LMS and for your text? What are the relationships that you have there?
That's a good question.
I just started by putting all the texts in Canvas, as pages on Canvas, and then But at, now that the textbook has been created by the students, it will be available online on the web.
Have you been stuck using Canvas?
No, I'll probably still use it for assigning and just linking out, but I'll let it live.
I mean, I used to use it for administrative purposes, for course content.
Right. I mean, this will be the first. I haven't done it yet, but I imagine that I'll just link to the website where the new anthology is located from within Canvas.
Using ShareOK, so wanted it to be accessible outside the walls of OU, and I think it's pretty universal that students in organic chemistry want as many problems to practice with as possible, so thought there would be a potential for a larger audience to take advantage of beyond just OU.
Did you start with was the first draft basically of your book material exported from?
No, it was all original content because we wanted to make sure that using the types of licenses that were being suggested that we look at, that this could be content anybody could take, rework, massage, turn into their own creative work. So this was all created from scratch.
So now, have you done that? Are you using LMS content?
I'll have to ask you, what is LMS?
Canvas or Desire to Learn, so I was trying to use it to mirror.
No. The links to the material are available through there, so that's kind of the hub that students go to in order to find where to go, but have not been doing that. I think the rationale, well, I'll just say the rationale behind that is that students may at times want to work offline, so they may want to have something when they go home over the weekend or when they aren't necessarily on the OU campus. And so trying to make sure that it was a resource you could download, save, and then you could work on it anywhere and you wouldn't have to be connected.
I think with D2L, it really doesn't go well with making an online book, but the Canvas system is pretty nice. And I went to the train on Canvas after I already wrote the book. So after the fact, I was like, ooh, I could have done this all on Canvas. And I don't know which way I would have done it if I had to do it over again. But it's probably best to have my own PDF that the students can just take, because otherwise in Canvas they're relying upon that system and we change it or something like that. So I like having one document, but I see the advantages of doing it in Canvas or something like that.
Well, my approach, I understand you're saying D2, but my approach is just to use it as a portal and not actually create content on Desire.
Right. And the book that I wanted to originally use as something I could modify, I found out we couldn't modify it. So what I do a lot of is I reference that book. Anytime I don't want to go off on a tangent and spend 10 pages on something, I'll reference this book. It's another open source book. So that's one way I've been able to kind of leverage another open source book in my book without actually taking their stuff, just using the links. Hopefully those links will stay good. You got me scared now.
I'm going to mention something, so thank you for mentioning this. One of the things that we will be doing next year is that all of these resources that are created or even used by any of the grantees, we now have a community on ShareOK, and all of these are going to go there, and this makes them findable throughout the world. So this helps with the sharing and the ability to other people to modify and find. It helps with stability because it's not going to go anywhere. The libraries are going to make sure that that content stays preserved and that it will not go away and there won't be link rot. So that's one of the things that we are going to start requiring of grantees. That's not to say you can still obviously use it in an LMS, in Canvas, and you can even make local changes, and we will have kind of a workflow for versioning as well. So that when somebody goes to ShareOK, they can see that, well, this was the first edition of the book, and it was, or of the resource, and it was used during these semesters. And now here's the one that is currently being used. So that's part of what we're going to be doing next year. Thanks for the question. Are there other questions? Yes?
Building on what you just said about the OER community space within ShareOK, is there any talk about reaching out to other universities to have them submit their OER content to a sort of a shared pool?
Yes. But right now, there are three universities using ShareOK.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what, and UCO is very, very new to ShareOK. So they have a whole set of resources that they are working on getting in there. I don't know what their OER situation is like. Mm-hmm. Certainly OSU, they also have a grant program. It's very new, and they will be creating resources. There's absolutely, and in fact, I know that they would be willing, able, and thrilled to put their resources in ShareOK. So, and I will mention that to them. Yeah. But right now, to deposit things, those agreements just aren't set up within the state. Did that answer your question?
I think so.
Okay.
It's just, you know, thinking about some of the smaller state, you know, the regionals, who maybe don't have the resources to run grant programs like this to maybe try to draw some of them.
Absolutely. Yeah. So once we have the community built up a little bit, absolutely we will be sharing that, no pun intended, with the world, really. Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah, absolutely. OU is also involved as part of the Open Textbook Network, and that is a very active group of academic institutions that share a lot of work, share a lot of knowledge. It's a network, and the Open Textbook Library. We will try. They have some very strict criteria about what can be uploaded to the library, but certainly some of the work that the panelists have done are eligible to be uploaded to that. So that makes these, again, more findable, more discoverable, and available to really anyone to be able to use content from it. So that's exactly right. This is an issue for the smaller institutions that don't have the funds, and they're the ones that need this the most.
Mm-hmm.
They really do. So for them to be able to then use it, you know, as is, or modify it would be fantastic. But you're right, they have to be able to access it.
Thank you.
We have 1 minute left. Any other questions? Okay, well, thank you very much, and I really want to thank the panelists for doing it.